It's no secret in BC, we've had a very serious fire season. This year, we've had over 3 million hectares of land burned. Let's put this size into perspective. We're in Abbotsford right now. If we drew a circle with the same area, it would make it as far south as Mount Vernon and as far north as my hometown of Squamish. It would also reach Vancouver Island. That's massive, and again, this is only over 1 year. So what are we going to do? In the interest of trying to make things better, today I'd like to talk to you about holistic wildfire management, or wildfire through multiple lenses. Let's start off with a relatively simple lens, the historical view of wildfire. We have to understand this first if we want to try to make things better. For over a century in BC, fire was only seen as bad. Fire threatened both timber and the safety of our communities. So, for the same period of time, we actively suppressed nearly every wildfire that we could manage. You could argue that this was effective in the short term, but for a few reasons we'll discuss, this has had consequences. Because we now know fires are a natural part of most ecosystems. Throughout BC, we've actually mapped out how often we could expect fire naturally throughout the province. We have a vast array of ecosystem types in BC, and each of these would be affected by fire differently. As an example, let's start with a lush coastal rainforest. Here we're talking about a fire frequency we could naturally expect around once every century to every second century. Our drier interior forests would naturally see fire every couple of decades, and our drier grasslands would see fire every couple of years. In the Pacific Northwest, we have evidence of this through photography. Here, we have the same landscape, but with two photos taken at different times. The left is from about 100 years ago, and the right is more recent. The landscape on the left could be described as a mosaic, meaning we can see a variety of vegetation across it. The picture on the right is more dense with vegetation and could be described as homogeneous. One major contributing factor of this is the complete suppression of naturally caused fires. Let's look at this through another lens. Imagine this is the same landscape from a century ago. There are mosaics of forests with different ages. And what I mean by this is, some areas have been burned recently, and others have not. Let's visualize the change in landscape over time and see the effects of removing fire. Without fire, the forests are growing over time and are becoming denser and denser. Now, when fire does start, it has access to a continuous fuel source. Combine this with climate change, and we have forests that are too dense, dried out, and ready to burn. There are other contributing factors as well, but I don't have time to talk about them today. We could describe an ecosystem like this as being in a fire deficit. So, we know we can't only suppress fire because there are consequences if we do. So we can look at fire through another lens, trying to understand it instead of solely suppressing it. Wildfire is volatile. To be able to positively interact with something that is volatile like wildfire, you really have to understand it. So let's start with the basics, and then we'll discuss how we can try to make things better. There are three things that affect fire behavior. We have weather, we have topography, and we have fuel. Weather is self-explanatory. Topography refers to attributes of the land like slope, and fuel refers to the material that is burning. In this example, we could say it's the vegetation that's built up over time. We have less control over weather and topography, and we have more control over fuel. So often, we manage the latter. When we do, it can be referred to as a fuel treatment. By augmenting fuel, we can manage our fire risk. Two ways to manipulate the vegetation are through cutting and burning treatments. Let's start with how option one works, cutting. In this circumstance, we're not cutting down every tree in the forest. We selectively remove attributes that are problematic for fire behavior. What do I mean by this? One of these attributes is ladder fuels. What's a ladder fuel? It's things like low-hanging branches and smaller trees. Ladder fuels enable fire to spread from the ground up into the crown of the tree. Crown fires are problematic because once they reach this point, they accelerate and spread very quickly. They're very dangerous and they're very difficult to control. So we can help mitigate this risk, like the picture on the right, by removing ladder fuels. And at this point, hopefully the fire is contained to the ground. Let's go back to the same forest we described as being in a fire deficit. What do? Well, we can remove smaller trees and ladder fuels, and again, this is visualizing it over time. Now, when fire is introduced, it's much more easily controlled. Another option we have to reduce fuel is through burning. I've started this speech by discussing how devastating fire can be. And I bet that at least some of you are asking yourselves, why would we want to introduce fire back into the landscape? Well, under the right conditions, doing this can have positive effects. Let's first discuss how these burns are different from uncontrolled wildfires. One difference is in timing. Remember when I said weather influences fire behavior? We don't have much control over weather, but we can wait and plan prescribed and controlled burning for favorable weather conditions. What do I mean by this? Prescribed burning is done when there is moisture, usually in the fall or in the spring. With this moisture, the fire burns less intensely and we have more control over it. I have a comparison for this. For a few seconds, humor me, visualize yourself driving at 50 kilometers per hour. Now picture yourself driving at 150 kilometers per hour. You have a lot more control at 50K than you do at 150K. Burning when there's moisture is like driving at a slower speed. With both responsible driving and controlled burning, you have more control, but you can still lose that control if you don't know what you're doing. Another question that often comes up is, what about the smoke introduced through controlled burning? We know how unpleasant wildfire smoke can be, but again, there are differences here. We can plan for favorable atmospheric conditions. And what I mean by this is, well, the atmosphere changes over time, and it's usually why we get differences in weather. There are days when if you burn, the smoke will linger. In comparison, there are days when if you burn, the smoke will more easily dissipate. So with meteorology, we can plan burns for when smoke dispersion is favorable. We still will have smoke, absolutely, but we'll have less days with it. Uncontrolled wildfires are significantly increasing our emissions. This year in Canada, we are expected to release 3 times as much carbon from our wildfires as we are from our whole economy. And think about how massive of a contributing factor that is. We have to ask ourselves, is what we're doing now working, and is it serving us well? We as a country often build ourselves up and talk about how we are trying to manage our carbon emissions, but often the elephant in the room that is wildfire is left out of this equation. Another difference in controlled burning. With prescribed burning, we have more control over the volume of smoke because we're not burning everything. Instead of clearing all trees like uncontrolled wildfire, we can be more selective again. If done right, controlled burning focuses on removing things like ladder fuels, smaller trees, and unhealthy trees. Both of these pictures are in the same forest about 200 meters apart and were exposed to the same wildfire on the same day. The picture on the right had a prescribed burning treatment 5 years ago, and the picture on the left had no treatment. On the right, we can still see grass and trees left behind the fire. Forests that have been treated proactively are more resilient to uncontrolled fire, and they regenerate sooner, or they heal sooner. In comparison, the forest on the left has been scoured. With no vegetation and productive soil, this forest will take significantly longer to regenerate or to heal, and it's actually more susceptible to things like debris slides and flooding because we don't have any vegetation holding the soil together now. We, as a province, are expected to spend over $1 billion this year alone on direct firefighting costs. This is the direct cost of wildfire over the last decade, minus this year. And everyone can look this up, it's public information. However, a new report from the Forest Practices Board estimates that indirect firefighting costs are 2 to 30 times higher than direct costs. So what's an indirect cost? These include things like loss of timber to mills, damage to watersheds and drinking water, and negative impacts on the tourism industry. Indirect costs may not be immediately seen, but they are still very real, and our tax dollars go towards this, and we could be spending our money better. So how are we going to do that? Another lens we could look through is trying to think about proactive wildfire management. Most people only think of wildfire when they see smoke, but there are things we should be doing other times of the year. During less severe fire conditions, we should be proactive in managing our forests through treatments such as cutting and burning. This is represented by the blue circle in text, and it's very much tied into the amount of moisture in the ecosystem. And on the right side, when we can expect severe fires, we need suppression and prevention. They are still key. We still need our fire crews to keep our community safe. FEMA has an interesting figure that for every $1 you spend in natural disaster preparedness, you save about $4. So a natural transition would be enabling people like the Wildfire Service, forestry companies, and local communities to do this work proactively. So what can you do? Another way that you can be proactive at a homeowner level and also at a community level is FireSmart, and they have lots of great resources online. Logan Lake was recognized as Canada's first FireSmart community. In 2021, the town was threatened by an active wildfire. However, because of their proactive work, their town was likely saved. The current fire chief of Logan Lake is actually quoted as saying, "If it wasn't for FireSmart, our town wouldn't be standing here today." The last lens I want to share with you is looking through First Nations experience. There are over 200 First Nations in BC alone that each have their own language, culture, and history. I do not speak on behalf of First Nations. Instead, this is me sharing my understanding of wildfire through my own research, conversations I've had, and what my elders have taught me as a fire keeper. Through written accounts and oral history, we know that some, but not all, First Nations in BC used fire proactively. When this is done, it is often referred to as cultural burning. Cultural burning was not only seen as beneficial to people, but for life in all its other manifestations, from the land, from the vegetation, and to the wildlife. First Nations understood and still understand that if you take care of the land, it would take care of you. In many cultures throughout the world, fire is often a part of ceremony and bringing together people. The history of fire management is a painful topic for many First Nations in BC. As a province, we outlawed cultural burning over a century ago. Historically, cultural burning was such an integral part of many First Nations' way of life that despite this, they risked fines, prison, and being branded an outlaw. Despite this painful history, there are currently First Nations that are working to revitalize these practices. And some are actively working together with the BC Wildfire Service, which is great. And at the same time, there are First Nations that do not feel enough trust yet. For us to work as a people with First Nations, there has to be principles such as relationship building, reciprocity, and trust. We cannot force healing, but if we're humble and if we listen, this can be an opportunity for us to work together to make things better for not only ourselves, but for the land and the seven generations that follow after us. Hopefully, I was able to expand your perspective on fire to look at it more holistically. Not all fire is bad, and there are circumstances when it can be a positive thing. By being proactive, we could spend our money better, both improving the safety of our communities and creating more resilient landscapes. The public has to understand the risks and benefits of controlled burning. And at this point in time, we have to tolerate some risk and some smoke, but it's better to have fire under controlled conditions. Thank you.